Okay, welcome again. Today we will move from the personal processes, the personal mental processes, to social processes, but it turns out that these social processes, of course, have to depend on personal processes. So therefore, we look at certain mental concepts and how they are at the basis of some social concepts. And that these mental things are also grounded in neuroscience, so they are biological. So for social processes, there are always two types of things. There are always the within-person parts and the between-person part. For example, we now communicate with each other, but there is a lot of infrastructure with wires and everything and internet that makes us connected. Without these wires, we would not even communicate. And if we would have a bad quality, then the communication would be also not so good. But also the within persons process is very important. So those two things are as kind of red line through this lecture. There is something like social contagion, which actually is based on this notion as well. And that may suggest that persons automatically follow each other, but that's not completely true. So there is still the question who is in control. So we will discuss that also as well. And we will finally come to notions like how is it possible that there can be a shared understanding between people and collective power. So that is the plan for today. Both cognitive and affective dimensions are addressed. So the first step has to be that we should wonder why the social phenomena are like they are. They are not so evident. It's even a bit unexpected. If you look at it, it's more like a kind of miracle than normal, I think. For instance, if you look at different persons, they have their own beliefs, desires, emotions, and intentions. While nevertheless, we have these coherent views in groups with decisions and also members that even feel good about it. So that's a kind of discrepancy. Would not expect that this would go together. For example, this is what you, from the individual side, would expect, that the individuals would just all go on their own and just move in a chaotic manner around each other. But that's not true. So therefore, the step has to be made to find an explanation why it's not like that. So that is the miraculous thing that you have to observe first, that it is not just normal. There should be something to achieve it, that there is such a lot of coherence. So remember this picture from, I think, Wednesday. The external and the internal mechanisms are depicted here. So these are the external mechanisms, like the internet, like we are using now. These are our own internal mechanisms. So these are the different parts of all of us are part of the world. We are all parts, and each of these parts thinks that it is a person. So, but that's not bad to think that. So it's a kind of conceptualization that helps a little bit giving structure. And of course, in the world, we have some skin that keeps us together. It's also a property of the world situation, the world parts. But the difference between internal and external mechanisms, that's what we indeed will consider here. Let's first check mechanism between persons. So it's important, of course, that expressions and behaviors of one person are observable by another person. If you would not hear me, then we would not have any interaction. So I should express things, and this expression should go through some physical medium, like through the air and to a lot of wires come in the air near you and then reach your ear. So that's the physical world between the person. So that physical world plays also an important role, and that should not be overlooked. For example, here, the communication maybe goes through the air and through the wires of internet and then back, because they don't have direct communication maybe, but probably they don't have even communication to each other. So that's a kind of thing that you have to keep in mind. The technical devices and infrastructure, they are very important. You can already think that using glasses to see better, using cameras, using social media, and these are many technical developments of the last so many years, going back already a longer time for telephone, but recently there are many other things. All these social media, they really have changed the world with respect to the mechanism between persons. So that means that a lot of things are different now than, for example, 30 or 40 years ago. And note that these social media, they can do different things. Some can do images, some videos. But I think in the future, there will be much more integration, that social media will do everything what the others do. All these things that you can do here, or all the interaction types, they include also emotions and not only information, which is also different from earlier mechanisms, like sending a letter. You have to read the information about emotions from the words and the chosen words. But now you can also see people when you talk to them. So that's all a real different situation in the current time. So let's now concentrate on the within-person mechanisms. So the line is that, like yesterday, we have found out what type of mechanisms can explain how people regulate their emotions. And in the assignment, we made some work on that and found out how to do it for the at least two different mechanisms, two different types of regulation. So that's type of mechanisms. We are now looking further for the mechanisms that relate to the social functioning, not to the emotion regulation. And these are the things that should be related in some way. So you do sensing and representing of expressions and behaviors of others. You interpret them, like forming beliefs about them maybe. You relate them to your own preparations and behaviors. You are also developing emotions and feeling about them. So these are types of things you should think how these things go together in some way. Now, there is fortunately a very strong development in neuroscience. That's a subdiscipline called social neuroscience. That's the neuroscientific basis of social processes, and that's exactly what we need here. And a central theme in that discipline is now that one person internally mirrors the internal processes of another person. So that mirrors has two sides. I will discuss them in a minute. And then this mirroring process and the own processes have some integration, because it's not that you have a part in the brain for the processes of somebody else and a part in the brain for your own processes. They are just mixed up. So this mirroring process is based on two core concepts. The first one is mirror neurons. I will explain it next slide. And the other one is internal simulation that we in fact already have seen in some cases, but that also plays a role here. The mirror neurons, they go back to the 90s. They were just by accident discovered for monkeys in Parma in Italy. So they were doing some experiment with a monkey where they had a cell, a neuron just recorded, and they did grasping actions with the monkey. So they looked, when the monkey was grasping something, what the Neurom did. Then they took a break and they took some coffee, and then one of the researchers picked up his cup of coffee, and then the neuron was firing as well, like it was firing when the monkey was doing the grasping. So that brought them to the idea there are apparently neurons that are active both when you prepare for an action or body state, or when you observe another person performing that same action. And they found out later that indeed that also is applicable for humans. They first have had it in a such type of monitoring, which has not a high resolution, both in spatial sense or temporal sense. But also later for epileptic patients, they also did single cell recording as they did with the monkey. And then they also found it. So it was finally also confirmed, although there was a kind of 10 years of discussion about it. Yeah, maybe animals have that, but not humans, because humans are always special. At least that's what some humans think. But in this case, it was clear that finally also humans have this same mechanism of mirror neurons. So the normal process in the brain goes from sensory representation to preparing for action. So that would mean that you would have some linear process, but here it is slightly different. We have the normal sensing to action line pathway here, but we already found out that there are many things that are more cyclic, like the evaluation, the internal loop here, the internal simulation that we also have seen in, for example, already in the ice cream example. But now you have a second type of sensing. Yes, you sense, you see that the other person is performing the action A, that same action A. And then, of course, you have a representation of that in the brain. But what happens then is that you don't go from that to any arbitrary thing, but you connect it to the same action in your own brain. So here you see how these pathways for observing somebody else for your own processes are not clearly separated. If they would have been clearly separated, this error would go somewhere else and you would have one block for the other people and one block for yourself, but that's not true, just mixed up here. So therefore, here you even don't know your preparation state, whether it's because of that or because of that. The state itself does not know that, it just has some activation. And then you can decide whether or not to perform the action. So these are some extra things to interpret your state here and to decide for an action that will come later. That's more part of the who is in control side. So that's already a small modeling construct that you can use to do the mirror neurons to have working in also in a network model. So therefore, this is a new light on certain things, that this separation is not so clear. And there is also the idea that was found out after a year, in a number of years, that it applies to expressing emotions on your face or by your body. Also in showing a tendency to go for some action. Also in talking and revealing intentions, beliefs, or opinions. All these things have some relation to such mirroring process. So the general pattern of internal simulation, maybe you still remember that, there is some preparation, but that preparation has a prediction link to predict the effect. If you would do that action, what would be the outcome of it? But this is still in the brain, not while you're doing it. So these are the action effect prediction links, and you can just continue, you can continue forever. There is a bit famous neuroscientist, German Heslov. He described this as one of the persons who described it the most clear way, say. He called it simulated perception action change. So you simulate your action here, and you simulate the perception of the effect of the action. And he has also a kind of theory of consciousness. He says, the conscious thought is, this is the way how it works. You just go from one thought to the other through such chains. So this is an example of internal simulation. So, so if you want to cross the street, there are these white bars on the street so that it, you can do it in a safe manner. So this guy tries to do that in Vietnam. Also look at his behavior. So what you see is that he looks very well to everybody coming, because he already knows that they will not stop like we should be expecting. But then he is looking very careful, and he has a variable speed. So he goes sometimes a bit faster, sometimes a bit slower, just to avoid the place where the other people will pass. So that's also a form of internal simulation. He simulates the way they are driving, and then he adapts his own behavior. So this is the idea of internal simulation, and you can use it for imagination, visualization, like you have in training in sports. Often people call it visualization there. Then you just imagine all actions you have to do in some action sporter that you have to that you are preparing for. You can use it for body states, for emotions. That's what we already saw in the discussion around emotion and feeling. And like the as if body loops, like DiMaggio described them. But you can also do it for decision making. There are some pointers also there where you can find more about it. Also, a very interesting area is too for mind reading. So if you do it for mind reading, then you simulate somebody else's mind in your own mind. And that also leads to empathy, for example. It can lead to empathy, but also like reasoning about somebody's intentions and all these types of things. So all these things relate to internal simulation. So mirroring processes as a whole, they are based on mirror states that become activated and internal simulation together. So then you have the mirror state activation here. And that's from another person's action that you observe. And then the simulation is predicted effect. So that's the whole thing. Sometimes in the literature, there is not so clear distinction sometimes. Sometimes they say that just the mirroring itself is the mirror state activation itself is actually the mirroring, but that's not realistic. The rest is also belonging to the same process. So therefore it's better to consider this as a whole. So that's another element that we can use in mental models. And this is an example where you have emotion. One person smiles, and you see the smile, you prepare for the smile, and you feel the emotion of the smile, even if you did not express it. Also, if you did express it, but also when you did not express it, you can still feel the emotion. That's related also to the topic of yesterday. So you see that their smiles, they have really a kind of spiraling effect on each other. So you really need to express that, of course. If someone has a poker face, you will never influence anybody. So then it should really be possible for somebody to express, but also to see it then. So that's again the question whether you can see each other. So now we have a slightly further picture. So here you have the normal, say, standard form of pathway, but here you have this special observation of another person doing A that also makes this working, and then you have the internal simulation of to predict the effect, and then you have feedback from that. So this is now a kind of building block. If you want to model social interaction between people, and you want to also go in some detail in the mental processes behind it, then this can be a useful part. Of course, this is a kind of minimal part. You can also make it a bit more rich with more states. But this is then a kind of minimum that you could use. So the mirroring is a mechanism for social contagion. So that's social contagion is in fact something that is often considered in social science areas. And then they just do not wonder whether there is something in the mental sense. So this mirroring is more from the psychology and neuroscience, and social contagion more from the social sciences, but also from psychology. Social psychology is also there, for example. This works for a wide variety of organisms. All of those have some form of mirroring. For example, this is another example of this social contagion. In this case, it's just cows. So also animals have social contagion. You see, this is a case where the cows were, during winter time, when it's a bit cold, they're always indoors. So in springtime, at one moment, they can come out for the first time. And that comes with some emotions, you can say. At least that looks like. Now you see that they really infect each other with the emotion. So this is a form of social contagion, you can say. So they will really go for a while. They will just run like this. So that's the idea. So this time it's not sheep following each other, but now there are cows. So then this social contagion, we again have this mechanism within persons that we have looked at and the mechanism between persons. Then how the emotion is expressed, seeing faces, all these things are important. Then we have again the physical world. For example, in a dark bedroom, you don't see faces, but you still can hear. So all these things have their influence. And especially, that's relevant also for this course, social media is a very important factor. So this mechanism within persons as a kind of summary, we have this expression of emotion, sensing, representing, responding, feeling also for it. You can also model this at different levels of abstraction. So now we looked inside, then you have some detail in the mental sense. But you can also see the following levels of abstraction, more abstract or less abstract. So this is the social network view, more abstract. And then you have single states per person, like in the assignment of today. The assignment is about opinion dynamics. Then each state of a person indicates the opinion level of that person. You have the behavioral view, where you indicate sensor states and execution states of persons, but you don't go inside. And you have the integrated view, where you also have the internal states, like we just saw. So this is the most abstract view. You have just an interaction between blocks, between states here. They are just states. Then you can make the behavioral view. Then you consider the input and output, say, the sensor and the executors of the persons. And then you have just straight connections from input to output. Or you go inside. And then you take this full picture for each person. So that's just a choice in modeling. It can be done, each of them can be done. That's just your own choice. So today for the assignment, we choose for the most abstract level. But later, and maybe also for your final assignment, you can consider also forms where the mental and the social come together. In that respect, there is some kind of abstraction that can be useful here. You can say this link determines whether the person really expresses the preparations. That's a kind of expressiveness factor. then indicated by epsilon of the person, and also on the other side, how things come in here from the other person is also a form of characteristic. You can call it delta, and it may have to do with the strength of these connections. So you could just, maybe it's just a product of these weights. You can just make this characterization of persons. Some persons have high expressiveness and less impressiveness, or the other way around, they're very open to change upon other people, but they express it not so much. So be aware that in such a network model, these network characteristics, like the connection weights, they do represent some characteristics of a person. So in this case, this weight represent the characteristic of a person, how expressive the person is. So then, let's go again here. So for example, you know those people that are sometimes like a kind of stigma even, indicated like to be a loner or or to a follower or a highly social person or a charismatic leader. And if you try to place them in this scheme of high or low openness, where would you place, for example, a highly social person? Would you place it here, for example? Or here, or here, or here? This one? Okay, yeah, the computer agrees with you, so. And a follower, where will you place this one? Would you place it here, here, here?
Maybe not so expressive, but very open.
Yeah, just the openness here and then low there, then it should be here. Yeah, you are right, the computer confirms this. A charismatic leader, where would you place that on the rest of the places?
Maybe with expressiveness being high and openness being low.
Yeah, those people, they are not influenced by anybody, but they just influence other people. That's what they do. Yeah, and then the loner has low both cases. The loner has not much interaction. It's not influenced, but it does not influence others as well. So these things can be related to your model. So if you want to model one of these types, you can just have higher or lower values of these delta and epsilon characteristics. So this is how you can vary models for specific types of persons. And that's in many cases a real important thing, because normally you don't model an average person. You try to model one specific type of person. And then you can do it like this. So this is only for this situation, but this applies, such similar things apply for, in general, for almost all situations, that the characteristics that you try to find in your model, they should fit to a certain person. So this was the integrated view. Then you have the persons themselves, so many internal structures with this expressiveness and outgoingness. Let me see. So if you look well, then this expressiveness is part, there is a causal pathway from the internal state of this person. If you view this just from the perspective of the world, then from this state to this state, there is a causal pathway through different areas. First, it's inside the person going, then between the persons, and then inside this person. And all of them have some relations to certain characteristics. So we already had this epsilon characteristic and the delta characteristic, but there is also the characteristic of this part of the pathway. So that's the openness and actually, so all of them, both of them have both. Huh? So, but then this part, you can call it a kind of channel strength. So how strong does something come further? If you see very sharp, it comes deeper in you, maybe stronger in you than when you see it very vague or very far away. So this is also a factor. So these are characteristics of persons, but this is a characteristic of the environment. Again, if we would not have our infrastructure for internet, then this alpha would simply be zero. We would not have any communication. So you can do this and I can do that or conversely, but this part will just be not there. So that's also a characteristic, but then from the external situation, external world. So this is then the situation. We have these three characteristics, and it's possible just to combine them in one thing. And that's what has been done. There are some examples of models that do that. They just take the product of the three, and that defines then the connection rate for the overall model at the most abstract level. So then you still can have these sub-factors, but they relate to the omegas that you choose for the connections between the persons. And the relation can be simply the product of them. Then you can see, well, there is at least a fraction epsilon that comes out. Then from that fraction epsilon, there is a fraction alpha that is given through the channel. Then from that channel, fraction delta is really getting inside. So that's how you can interpret this. So these are just some practical options in modeling that you could use. So what is it make that, what is it that us, that makes us human? That's a question that you can talk very long about yet. But what we have seen until now is not all, of course, because only being influenced by others is not all of what is there. So there are also things as feeling responsible for your own actions. You make deliberate decisions, at least you think so. You have control, also, at least you think so. And you feel things for each other. And you distinguish yourself from others. This is very important. This is another element that has to be added on top of this mirroring. And you can show empathy. Showing empathy is not showing the same emotion. If somebody cries and you also have a sad face, then it doesn't say by itself automatically that is empathy. Maybe it's just you think you're sad yourself. Maybe you don't even know that the other person is sad. So, but we will go into that a bit further in a while. You can read others' minds, as you already mentioned. So there is a lot of things that you can do here. You can just explore these things and find out what are the mechanisms behind these things in the literature. And they are very good inspiration to make computational models, because for computational models, we also need mechanisms. So in fact, we are looking for mechanisms that make us human. So now I come back to the question, who is in control? So we have seen that there are multiple functions of these mirror neurons, preparing or observing or both. And that means you mix up things, your own processes and the process of others. So then this question becomes interesting and important. So you can wonder about effective mechanisms to let your own processes be affected. So can you decide about it? That's a bit of a question. In principle, it is good for social cohesion that people affect each other, but it may lead to a serious mess in your brain in a certain way. I mentioned already throwing stones, for example, earlier. If you are throwing stones to somebody because other people are doing that, you cannot tell a judge that they did it because others did it, that they are the ones that are responsible. So given that mirror states have multiple roles, multiple functions, they can either relate to observation or preparation, the meaning of them has to come from additional information by representing some context aspects. And that's what you can also do in a model. So there should be states representing this context in a certain way. And an important element of such context is self-other distinction, what I already have mentioned. So you should be able to say whether or not some active mirror state is related to the person, your own self, say, or to another person. That is what you call self-other distinction. And there are states for that. There are specific neurons that represent the self-other distinction. Well, we can also model that. It's also not too complicated. So we add just one kind of self-other distinction state that also serves in a sense of control. And there are even two of them. This X is a variable. You can have one for the other agent or one for yourself. So for the other agent, it can just come from the observation that you know it's the other agent, the other person. Or the one for yourself can come from your own observation of the sensory representation, for example. And then this state can determine whether or not you code for the action, or whether or not you code to the communication that you tell the other one. I see that you do A, for example. I see that you are smiling, or I see that you are sad. So that's also part of the empathic reaction. So this is then the empathic response. So suppose somebody is crying or is just very sad and you see that, then all these mechanisms work. And you see also that's the other person, not yourself, but still you are affected. You're still also becoming a bit sad and show a sad face. And then you say, oh, why are you sad, or are you sad, something like that, and you have the sad face. Well, this example is completely the opposite. Then you see a smiling face here, you also smile, and you say you are happy. Why are you happy, for example? So this is actually in the literature described as what are main ingredients of showing empathy, and the mechanisms by it, they need a mirror state like here. And you also, in fact, you can use the internal simulation, but I left it out of this picture, but normally you can think that's also there. And this new control state for the self-order distinction. So that's also in some way that you can, a kind of building block that you can use for modeling. So mirroring has a very wide perspective in the literature. There are also writings about spiritual religious experiences. You can see some references here, but you can also search on internet if you're interested in it. There are also some people that they are mechanisms that finally will lead to collective consciousness and global empathy. They have an optimistic view of how it goes further for the future. So you can just find more literature if you're interested in such types of relationships. But let's now consider one of the two main notions in the title of today's lecture, the shared understanding. So here, understanding is used as indicating a form of representation or conceptualization of external situation by internal states. Like you can have a belief or just a representation as an image, but you can also have a feeling. You can feel something about some external state. You also take that as possible on understanding. Now, mirror processes can take place for any internal state like emotions or beliefs. And due to this mirroring, this social contagion happens, of course, like we saw. And then you affect each other in such a way that you can converge to shared understanding. That's also what you will see in the assignment of today. These opinions, they can go together. And in that assignment, we have two groups that are only loosely connected. If this connection is very weak, then the groups can have different opinions. But if the connection has some strength, then finally they will have the same opinion. So this is a way how this mirroring process explains how this shared understanding is possible. And of course, that also depends on external mechanisms, whether or not there are channels open between the persons. This is just a small example. There are different populations. There are people that think that the climate is changing. There are people that think that it is not changing. This still becomes more and more a minority. But there are also people that think it is changing due to human action. But there are also people that say, yeah, I agree that it's changing, but it's not due to human action. There's a natural process. And there are also people that the climate is not changing, and that is due to human action. Otherwise, it would have become colder. And those people, they say it's not changing and also not due to human action. So that's different forms of shared understanding that have come together. And so now I distinguish between cognitive and affective understanding. So it's affective understanding is that you have some feeling about something, and cognitive that you have some cognitive state like a belief. So examples, believing that the climate is changing and feeling bad about it. That's typically quite plausible way of understanding. Believing that a new iPhone has come out and feeling good about it. That's also a familiar type of situation maybe. There is also a marketing wisdom that says, do not only provide positive information, but also a positive emotion about a product that you want to sell. This is a very important idea. So in advertising, you always see smiling people. And that's not for nothing. It's just to trigger your own mental mechanisms. It also applies to persons like politicians. If you should vote one of them, you would vote this one, of course, because he smiles, he doesn't smile. You could also vote for this one, but this is not actually a politician. So here, of course, this is already for 10 years, Prime Minister of the Netherlands, so yeah, he smiles often. Also for TV personalities, like our famous Linda de Mol, also is always smiling. So the smile is very important to bring people together, so the positive emotion. So there is unfortunately also a negative type of similar marketing wisdom. If you both have negative information and a negative emotion associated to something, a product, then that has also an extra strong effect. And this can also be applied to persons, and then you come to the area of bullying or cyberbullying. For example, bullying, you can point at a certain characteristic of a person, like the body shape or whatever, and then make a negative feeling around it. So that's how it works in a kind of double situation. So therefore this cognitive and affective understanding, they usually cooperate in a certain way. So let's look at it a bit further. Any cognitive state triggers some associated emotional response. We have seen that already in cases like yesterday. So this then an as-if body loop activates the body state and you have the feeling. So these automatic mechanisms are available in every person. And you can also have the similarity of a person here. If a person is, for example, identical twins, they have much more similar brains than other people probably. And then it will even work more in the same way. So what happens now is that you have these as-if body loops internally in the person, but also the mirroring and then the interaction. They get a kind of integrated, emotionally grounded shared understanding. You know about things, and at the same time you have the same feeling about it. Now that gives a very strong binding effect between persons. So this also has, again, this distinction between external and internal factors can be considered. And you can also have understanding about things in the external world or about persons. So persons are also part of the world. So you can also especially look at persons and have understanding about them. So then if you have an understanding of person states, then you come in the area of mind reading, theory of mind, or empathy. So this is a kind of scheme that gives an overview of all kinds of possibilities. You can have an understanding and a shared understanding about persons here, persons or things outside persons. That can be cognitive understanding, knowing things about persons and about the external world. Or it can be affective, having a certain feeling for it, having a feeling about some state of another person, or having a feeling about the state of the world, or both. That's the most general case, that you have both. Often you have both for people and for things. Then that can be related for the specific case that you talk about persons, only the person internal understanding. Then you can have affective states of a person or a cognitive state of a person or both. Then you can have these things. If you have affective understanding of affective states, that means effect is just emotion contagion. You feel things about the feeling of another person or related to the feeling of another person. That happens by the mechanism of emotion contagion. You can have a cognitive understanding of a person. Then you have you can have that about affective state. You can know about the feelings of somebody else. Or you can know about the beliefs of somebody else. Or you can know about both. You can know about the belief and also about the feeling that the person has. Well, these things are called theory of mind. Then you know about things. You know how somebody is, but you don't feel anything. So here you only feel about something, but here you only know. Then, of course, we have the total package. That's the knowing and feeling for other persons, and other persons' feelings and also their cognitive states. Then you have, these are forms of empathy. You have, in this case, affective focused empathy, so about the feelings of somebody else and also showing those feelings yourself. This is about beliefs of another person, for example, and then you have cognitive and affective understanding. You know about the beliefs and also feel about these beliefs. This is the full, everything full. So these are different gradations of how you can work with the connectiveness and empathy between persons and mind reading. So this scheme gives a bit of overview, kind of map where you can go to if you want to do something there. This is a very interesting area to do this. So finally, I will just go into the emergence of the collective power. That's the other main social phenomenon in our title of today. Again, if you have these individuals that just go like this, they don't exert much power because all powers go in different directions and this they annihilate each other. So this is not the picture how it happens, because we know that groups of people, they develop collective power. So this is cannot be the right picture. So to obtain collective power, you should converge with all those individual directions to some collective situation. We also have a physical metaphor here. Note that charismatic leaders usually do this, know how to create it by their own high expressiveness. And these are a number of people that can be thought of that were very good or are very good in that. I think were in this case. So the social media strengthen these processes. So social media strengthen the process of the shared understanding, of course, because they transfer both information and emotions. It's very important that also the emotions are transferred by social media. Therefore, they are much stronger than media that we had before that do not transfer emotions so very well. But this is the physical metaphor. I want to show it a little bit. So this is how things work in the universe. There are also there many small particles. You see here, each of these particles has not much power, but there is something like a form of attraction, and that's in this case is called gravity. Like we have seen that there is attraction between persons based on mirroring. So that mechanism is also here. They come together, they form bigger units, bigger objects, and yeah, you can imagine that after a while you don't want to have such an object on Earth. So that's how it, what is the physical metaphor here for the situation. So that means that we have found out certain ways where, why this shared understanding and shared this collective power is based on this mirroring. And it's not only mirroring of the actions or intentions or the cognitive states, but also the mirroring of the feelings underlying it. You can also remember this. This is also a kind of collective state. This, this sheep that are going around here, they form also a collective. And because of that, it's difficult for the car to drive further. So there are many cases where you can see such such things that go that join forces in a certain way. And again, I want to emphasize the role of emotion-related thingness, because emotions are a very important thing. Even if you want to come to a collective decision or a joint decision, you should take into account the underlying emotions. You cannot let people go for a decision where they don't feel well about. So the emotions are very important also in that case. So that means that the predicted effects should be valued as satisfactory, then the action can be chosen. And then this whole machinery behind that also takes place. And also the interaction, contagion should not only do the cognitive side, but also the feeling side, the emotional side. I think then most things are there. I still want to, also because of the time. Yeah, so just one thing. So the whole thing has then a solid emotional grounding if you take both into account, not only beliefs or opinions, but also the underlying emotions. But I want, and the social media do that very well. I already have, then you have a kind of double effective way of doing. I will skip this a bit further. Yeah, I want to show this at least. So within a person, you have many processes, many processes and cyclic processes going on. Like in this case, for example, a cognitive state and an emotional state that have mutual relations, and also in another person. And then if you have both on these both levels, contagions for the informational or belief state, the cognitive state, and also for the emotion, then you have a kind of double contagion, cognitive and affective, and that is double effective. It has a double effective, a double strong binding effect between the persons. And I think that is most that I want to show. Maybe the rest I can just skip it. Yeah, so there are some application areas for this. You can look at that in detail. I want to be a bit fast now, so you can just read it if you want to have some impression of possible topics. All of these elements can be interesting topics for your final assignment. But I want just to finish by addressing assignment 3 of today. These are the social network simulations for such a social network. You have two groups. You see there are many relations, not all of them. There are some not some relations not, but at least there are many relations in one group and also in the other groups. And there is only one small relation. One of this group knows somebody else of the other group. And then you can do simulation experiments with opinion dynamics, given the type of things that I've discussed, but in this case only on this level, we've limited to that level only, and only for opinions. And you can do many types of variations of it. That's what the assignment shows you. One thing I want to point at this, we use the scaled sum function for the nodes there, for the states, but you always have to set the lambda, the scaling factor, to the sum of the weights, because then it becomes the weighted average of the aggregated impact, becomes the weighted average of the source state values. And that's otherwise, if you don't do that, if you take it above the higher, then it can go above one. If you take it lower, then all activity drops to zero, which is also not so interesting. So just normalize it, that's what it's called, by taking always the sum of these. That also means that if you change, you make a variation by changing connection rates, you have to adjust this lambda as well. So keep that in mind, that you don't, if you come in a situation that you see that everything goes to zero, probably your lambda is too big, too high. So just think of it. I think this is what I wanted to say. Are there questions at this moment? Shall we just move to the breakout rooms?